The U.S. and other powers made ready today to enforce a no-fly zone and other measures in Libya. President Obama said the world would not be deterred by Muammar Gaddafi's claims of a ceasefire.
The president spoke in the East Room of the White House this afternoon after conferring with congressional leaders.
Let me be clear. These terms are not negotiable. These terms are not subject to negotiation. If Gaddafi does not comply with the resolution, the international community will impose consequences, and the resolution will be enforced through military action.
The terms include stopping the advance to Benghazi and pulling back from three other towns. The authorization for military action came Thursday evening. The UN Security Council approved a no-fly zone and all necessary measures to protect Libyan civilians from pro-Gaddafi forces. The vote was 10 to none, with five abstentions, including Russia, China, and NATO member Germany. Later, Libya announced it was halting all military operations. But Libya's ambassador to the U.S., who no longer supports Gaddafi, voiced serious doubts.
We have to be very careful. This is a trick. This man, he will come in the resolution, but in the same time, he is invading Misrata. He is killing the people. He is moving his armies from two strategic points. Please, you have to be very careful with this.
The French echoed that skepticism. They and the British were taking the lead in planning the military operations against Libya.
Mr. Gaddafi has declared a ceasefire, but you know, he has made so many declarations, each one more exotic than the other, declarations in these last few weeks that have been increasingly frightening. So one more declaration doesn't have a lot of significance or impact.
It was unclear when military action might begin. The British began deploying Typhoon and Tornado attack aircraft to the Mediterranean region, and Italy said it would allow its air bases to be used. The exact U.S. role remained unclear, but the president stressed it would not include ground troops. Several American warships were already in the area, including an amphibious assault ship, plus 400 U.S. Marines, and dozens of helicopters.
Images coming out of Libya today illustrated the conflicting claims of what was going on inside the country. In Tripoli, Jonathan Miller of Independent Television News has more on the day's developments.
Benghazi's wild celebrations, fireworks, flares, the old tricolor flag, gunfire, cheering and chanting went on all night and into the new day. It's not deliverance, but for the besieged city, international protection is the next best thing. 3 p.m. local time, and in Tripoli, a grim-faced Moussa Koussa, former head of intelligence turned foreign minister, made a terse statement.
Therefore, Libya has decided an immediate ceasefire.
He called for dialogue. The resolution, he said, was a violation of Libyan sovereignty and said it was strange and unreasonable that the UN had sanctioned the use of military power. But it's not so strange, given persistent reports post-ceasefire announcement that rebel-held Misrata, 130 miles east of Tripoli, remains under heavy bombardment. The government denies this. We can't authenticate these pictures, but they accord with eyewitness reports. 25 killed, doctors say. So much for the immediate ceasefire.
They're still shelling the city. I hope you can hear the gunfire in the background. About an hour ago, two shells landed across the road from the medical center into the local hotel there.
Colonel Gaddafi had warned that his troops would have no mercy. The UN had no right to intervene, he said, branding it madness. If the world has gone crazy, he said, then we will go crazy too. At 2 a.m. local time, 2 hours after the UN vote, angry protesters interrupted an emergency news conference at our central Tripoli hotel. Britain and America have let us all down once again, they chant.
These demonstrators knew exactly where to come. They just raided the hotel in which all foreign journalists were staying.
Listen, a whole bunch of demonstrators have just invaded a hotel with foreign journalists.
No, guys, please, guys.
They saw us on TV because this was broadcast live.
So they came to the hotel that fast.
They live here. This is the neighborhood. Oh, come on now. Don't do that to me.
Tripoli's pro-Gaddafi mobs, who've continued today to play to the Foreign Press Gallery, can read between the lines of the UN resolution. The stated objective was to stop bloodshed, but the unstated objective is pretty clear: regime change.
And now more on The View from Benghazi. Al Jazeera reported late today that Gaddafi's forces continued advancing to towns 30 miles from the city. Earlier, Hari Sreenivasan talked by Skype with James Foley of the international website GlobalPost, who was at a restaurant in Benghazi.
James, what was the celebration like on the streets of Benghazi when they heard the news that the UN Security Council had approved a no-fly zone?
Around midnight, when word came out about the UN resolution, the square just erupted with gunfire, later fireworks, and spontaneous marching. It was by far the most firing I've heard in my several days here, and it continued throughout the night.
We've heard a lot about Gaddafi taking over other cities. What are you hearing outside of Benghazi?
We just heard from an eyewitness that Ajdabiya is continued to be shelled and bombed today, even after the ceasefire. In fact, it might have intensified.
Do people you talk to trust Gaddafi's offer to create a dialogue with the opposition?
Not at all. The people on the street are up to life. After 42 years, they don't believe that he will keep to a ceasefire, and there's no feeling to show him any mercy. You know, one man said, we don't trust him. He does it because of the no-fly zone. He only respects power, and now that the West is involved, there's power involved.
James Foley from Global Post reporting from Benghazi via Skype.